church. Good morning. Oh, perfect. Welcome to church. First Sunday of the new year. Hey, we're so glad you made it out. My name's Scott. I'm one of the ministers here. And so whether you've been coming here a long time or a family member brought you in, or if you're watching online from the comfort of your couch, we still will pray for you. We are so glad you're here. And we invite you to stand up as we participate in this worship together. I pray that as this service goes on, you will be encouraged and empowered to lean a little further into your faith, both today and as you head out into 2023. Let's sing together.
Responsive reading. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to his people. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. So let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things.
Oh, please enjoy a seat and join your heart with me in prayer. God of new beginnings, as we shift from the Christmas celebration behind us to the calendar year ahead of us, we thank you that in this world, nothing stays the same. Good times end and bad times end as well. And you, Lord, are the only thing that never changes. You are the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And we praise you that in the elusiveness of time, we can always count on your presence. And Lord, we recognize that in Jesus Christ, our light has come, yet often we choose to walk in shadows and ignore the light. We don't trust you as Lord of our life, and we lean on our own ways to get along in this world. And so, Lord, we confess. We confess to you today that we have sinned against you and one another in both our actions and our inactions. Maybe some of us are harboring regrets from the past year or resentments that are being carried into the new year. Help us, Lord, to start anew, to receive your forgiving grace, to extend that to others, and to desire more than anything to become the people you've created us to be. And Heavenly Father, as we form our vision of the upcoming year, we pray that your Spirit would work in us the fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. May we be open to how your intentions for our lives ultimately lead to producing these fruits in all that we do. And Lord, we also lift up to you now the prayer concerns of our hearts, whatever we come here with today that's weighing on our hearts or our minds, whether it be for ourselves or loved ones, whether it be prayers for health, comfort, peace, love, joy. And so, Lord, hear the concerns of our hearts. And we also pray today, Lord, for blessings upon our community, our nation, our world. Lord, we pray for justice, for peace, and for leaders who will serve the common good through their power. And ultimately, Lord, may you inspire each one of us to do our own part in carrying the gospel message and in serving others. As Jesus taught us what love looks like, serving one another, may we live that out in our daily lives and look for opportunities to serve those around us. Almighty God, we lift up these prayers to you today, and we do so in the strong name of Jesus, our light and our salvation. Amen.
So good. And all my life you have been so, so
to highlight some of the things in this new year that are going to be starting up again. Our theme should be starting again, because there's lots of things starting up again, and you'll see in your bulletin what those things are. One thing that we're very excited about at the end of January, the very last week going into the 1st of February, we are hosting our denomination's national gathering. So we have an annual gathering for ECO, and this year it's here at St. Andrew's, and so we would love for your help. We're going to need lots of volunteers to help with many things. And so you can contact, you'll see in the bulletin that you can contact Rachel and learn more about how you can participate and help make it a very successful event that week. So we're excited about that. Also coming up, starting up again, is our January programming. So things that have been put on hold over the holidays, over Advent, you'll see in your bulletin and online, lots of things are coming again. For instance, our Wednesday night together is going to be starting up. And these all are pretty much the second week of January. You'll see the dates in your bulletin and online. We'll have Wednesday night together starting. We'll have the women's Bible study on Monday evening, Tuesday morning. Those are starting up. We're also going to have our Sunday morning class after our first service of the morning. That's called the Great Questions. That will be starting up. So lots of goodness ahead for us. So do get informed about all of that. Another piece of information for you is our winter brochure. And if you haven't gotten that, please do get one on your way out. It is chock full of great stories and lots of information about what our church is up to. And that just leads into the next section here, our next part of our worship, which is our offering. And our winter brochure is a great example of how your giving goes so far at this church and touches so many lives and makes ministry happen for so many people of all different ages. So as you give this morning, know what it is going to. It is going to further the kingdom of God through St. Andrew's. So our ushers are going to come forward now. Let us give our offerings with generosity and with joy.
If you have felt the dark of night, questioning what is out of sight, He is the answer, He is the light. If you have felt the weight of sin, bound by the shame that I
I want you to imagine with me for a moment that you couldn't see. In fact, it had been quite some time that you couldn't see. You used to be able to see, but your memories of color, your memories of what your friends and family looked like were fading into the background, and it began to ruin everything in your life. In fact, it had not just began, it had completely changed everything about the way that you lived. And so you had to stop working, you had to start begging, you had to just do whatever you could to survive. And so you found that if you sat by this one gate, you'd get a lot of people that would help you. But as the days, weeks, months, and years went on, fewer and fewer people would give. And so you just tried to beg to survive, to see what you could do. But then one day, you heard he was coming. Oh, you've heard of this man before. You heard of the stories of how the guy who couldn't walk now could walk again. You heard the story of the little girl who was dead or asleep, but you knew what that really meant, and now she's alive. You heard the story of that other guy who was blind, but now he could see. I have heard of this person before, and he was on track to come right through my gate. And so you would scurry across to try to find the best position to be able to happen to bump by him and intersect him. You couldn't see, but you could hear the voices of the crowd beginning to murmur bigger and bigger. You knew he was coming up from Jericho, so you knew the exact road to get on to intersect him. And as the crowd started to get louder, you thought, he must be here. He must be close. So you started calling out, Son of David, Son of David, a title that would hearken. You knew who this man was. He wasn't just the Messiah. He was the one who was going to save us all from the Roman Empire. You start calling out louder and louder, knowing that he's around, but not quite knowing where he is. And people start hushing you. Stop talking. You're being too loud. You're interrupting him. But this was your moment. Nothing could stop you from this. Your desperation, the days, weeks, months, and years of sitting there, blind and in pain, trying to live your life. You aren't going to let this moment pass by. So the louder you shout out, Son of David, have mercy. And then someone comes to you. Hey, bud, it's your lucky day. He's calling you. Yes, he's calling me. And in the excitement, you throw your cloak, you throw everything, and you begin to run, even though you have no idea where you're running to. And someone helps escort you, and you can just feel that you're getting closer to this person. And the question that's asked of you is, what do you want me to do for you? Can you imagine the God of the universe looking at you and saying, what do you want me to do for you? That question, that idea absolutely fascinates me. In fact, the last year, 2022, I think this is the passage that I have mulled over most in my mind and in my studies, because I can't get over that question, what do you want me to do for you? The God of the universe coming, giving you a blank check, fill in the number. And so today I want to explore this a little bit, and we're gonna have some fun. Whether you're here with us today, you're online, you're here because you want some depth, so I'm going to give it to you, and we're going to be tracking through the Bible. If you didn't know, one of those little books in front of you is a Bible. We're going to go through it, and we're going to read it. I encourage you to grab it and open it, because we're going to have some fun. And we're going to talk about this passage in the context of rejoicing. And so what's happened with me over this last year, I've looked at it in different like facets. The old Jewish tradition would be to look at a passage, and just like you would analyze a diamond from different perspectives, that's what I've done this last year. And in prep for New Year's Day, we're here, 2023 is starting. There is an angle that God showed me that I had never quite seen before in the years of going through this. And so here's what we're going to do today. We're going to talk about this idea of resolving to rejoice and what that means. And ultimately, you're going to walk away with a few ways that you can resolve in your soul to rejoice in 2023, but in your person as yourself. To do that, we're going to look at two biblical stories, a little bit of a structural analysis. We're going to talk about the transcendentals, which is a fascinating philosophical construct. Then we're going to go to a few application ideas, follow up with a New Year's resolution. Sound good? So, as we're going through this journey, if you're having a hard time holding on because you're up past 9:01 p.m., how many of you guys made it till 9? Okay. Well, hey, grab. So, if you're falling asleep, you're having a struggle, resolve to rejoice, I promise you, we'll end right back there. But if you're willing to go on this journey with me, well, we're going to start over with Paul in prison, writing a letter after going through beatings and after being shipwrecked and after a ton of pain and suffering that this man went through. He gives us an idea that I think is absolutely fascinating. It's Philippians 4:4. It says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Nudge your neighbor who might be falling asleep and say, rejoice in the Lord always." Here's what's interesting to me. When I think about this verse, again, Paul's writing from a position of like pain and suffering. And he's inviting us as believers to rejoice in the Lord always. I was talking to a friend of mine, and they were processing through this, saying, like, how can you just be happy always? There are times when I'm happy, and there's times when I'm sad. And this is not what Paul's saying. Paul isn't saying to just be happy always. He's saying, rejoice in the Lord always. There's some complexity there that whether you're having a fantastic day or whether you're in the midst of the suffering, there's an invitation to rejoice. Because I believe this idea of rejoicing is much more than an emotion. It is a lens with which we can view life. It is a construct to approach our scenarios to while even holding depression, while holding pain, while holding anxiety, we can have a lens to surround that to be able to see God. And so in this idea of rejoicing in the Lord always, to have that framework, how do we do that and why should we do that? Well, first, I think in terms of addressing the why question, why should you rejoice in the Lord always? And I truly believe it is because God has come to bring wholeness to your life. Now, you won't see the fullness of that wholeness come this side of heaven. But God has come so that you may have more of him and you may encounter more of his purpose and his plans and what he's doing in and through you. You might have been a Christian for your entire life, and I will say here boldly, there is more for you that you're not even aware of. The depths of what God has for you are unfathomable. And so why should you rejoice in the Lord always? There is more, and if you're willing to go after it, you will be blown away by what God wants to do. The other part is your character. I do believe that there is something to our character that God is constantly molding and shaping in us. And so some of you might just be in a place where you're barely hanging on. The pain, the suffering, whatever you're going through is at its extreme, and you've tried everything, you've done the Christianese, but it's still not working. And I would say that God has a plan and a purpose for you too, in so much as he is concerned about your character, and I believe far more than your comfort. And so in this process of being able to rejoice in the Lord always, even when you're in prison, there is something God is doing in you to help awaken and activate things that you weren't even sure were possible. So, jump with me to Mark chapter 10. In this context of rejoicing in the Lord always and processing through that, pull out your Bible. If you haven't opened a Bible in a while because you use your app, that's okay. It's page 1575. We're going to start at verse 46. Then they came to Jericho, Jesus and his disciples together, with a large crowd. Next page, 1576. The large crowd. They were leaving the city, and a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Again, that's an interesting title because this wasn't just, "Hey, Messiah," you're really familiar with this term, Son of David. But culturally, there was much more to this. This was hearkening a little bit of an idea that there might be a military essence that Jesus would come in with. Ironically enough, the very next passage, Jesus enters Jerusalem, not on a horse like a military conqueror would, but on a donkey. Like someone who would to bring peace. Many rebuked him, verse 48, and told him to be quiet. But he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called the blind man. "Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you." The Message translation by Eugene Peterson, he translates that to say, "Hey, it's your lucky day." No one saw the beauty of what was happening underneath here. But Jesus was up to something interesting. Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. And here's that question, 51. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said, "Rabbi," interesting title, "I want to see." Now, what I find interesting is as I kind of mulled over this last year, this verse, "What do you want me to do for you?" It wasn't until recently that I began to look at the structure of this passage. What you can find is as you analyze the Bible, the Jewish authors are brilliant in how they structure it. And so the passage before, the passage after, has a lot to tell you about what's happening in your passage. And so I began to do a structural analysis to say, what does where this story fits in the grand scheme of Mark, what does that have to communicate? And by and large, the immediate story preceding has the same question that Jesus asks, "What do you want me to do for you?" Let's go take a look at it. We're going to jump to verse 35. Chapter 10, just a few verses earlier, 35. Flip the page back. Then James and John, these two were the two of the three. Peter, James, and John were Jesus' like inner circle. So James and John, they're brothers. They approach Jesus. "Teacher," they said. Notice the difference in title. They say teacher, which is an appropriate title. He is their teacher. But this blind man, he doesn't say teacher. He says rabbi. The idea of this rabbi concept is much more than just a, hey, you're a great teacher. There's some depth there. There is a, hey, you are someone who can save me, and I recognize you as such. There's a desperation coming from this blind man. Whereas over here, James and John, they're friends of Jesus. Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. Verse 36, there's that question. What do you want me to do for you? What do you want me to do for you? And I think it's interesting. I believe Mark is creating this parallel. James and John, two of Jesus' closest friends, and this blind beggar, Bartimaeus. What do you want me to do for you? Here's what they say. Let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in glory. What a question. Jesus, when you get to glory, let us flank you on either side. Like, we want the status, we want the position. And I think that's absolutely fascinating. Like, okay, I get it. Like, you're trying to gain status. You're close to Jesus. You're trying to figure out, like, hey, what's going to come? How can we do this? And Jesus says, you don't know what you are asking. And I can only imagine that Jesus responded to that thinking of what was about to come in a week where he would be at the cross and there would be two thieves flanking his left and his right. He says, you don't know what you're asking because my place of glory is going to be on this cross. He continues, you will drink the cup that I drink and be baptized. All right, I'm sorry, verse 38. Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with? We can, they answered, yes. And he's like, it's going to be a tough road for you. You don't, verse 39. We can, they answered. Jesus said to them, well, you will drink the cup I drink and you will be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with. But to sit at my right or my left is not for me to grant. These places belong for those for whom they've been prepared. And I just think that's fascinating, the idea of Jesus having a double meaning here. There's the cross. That's my place of glory. You don't know what you're asking because there's going to be people on my left and right. But in the age to come, there's more to it there too. But in this, you have them looking for position, and yet you have blind Bartimaeus looking for presence. Let's jump back to him, blind Bartimaeus. 51, what do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked him. The blind man said, Rabbi, I want to see. Go, Jesus said, your faith has healed you. Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. Go, your faith. To break down that word, this idea of faith has three heads to it. It's this idea of trust, hope, the spiritual faith, but this nature of trusting Jesus with all that you have, this resolution. And I think in the spirit of New Year's resolutions, rejoice in the Lord always, I want to show you how to resolve to rejoice, but the first step of that is resolving in your heart to trust Jesus. To no matter what you encounter, to bring who you are to the feet of Jesus. Bring your life, bring your struggles, bring your successes, bring your failures, and bring them all before Jesus and say, hey, this is all I got. God, I want all of you. Now, that's really easy for me to stand up here and preach and say, hey, just trust Jesus, go on your way, have a wonderful 2023, and you won't be any better for it, because it's easy to think, yes, I want to trust Jesus, and that's nice, and I want to be a good Christian. But to actually live that out, how do you actually process the idea of trusting Jesus? Well, buckle up, it's difficult. Not only that, Jesus doesn't promise when you follow him that life will get amazingly better. In fact, he promises that life will continue to be difficult. What he said to James and John, the cup that you're about to drink is tough. All of the disciples were brutally massacred for what they believed in regards to Jesus. And if you're following Jesus, you can guarantee some of that path is the same. A pastor I heard once said, if God didn't spare his own son from the cross, what makes he think he'll spare you? I'm like, that is tough. But the invitation there of what God is doing beyond the superficial and in your soul so that you may gain wholeness, so that you may develop your character, so that you can become all God's created you to be, both for this age and for the age to come, well, I'll sign up for that. I'll sign up for the God of the universe saying, the road will be tough because of the consequence of sin, but I'm going to be with you in those tough places. You just got to trust me. Okay, I'm in. How do I trust you? How do I break that down? So as I begin to think this, and I'm imagining the blind man, Bartimaeus, as he initially stood up, he's blind, he's coming towards Jesus, what must have been going through his head? Each step that he is taking and framing how he might respond to this Jesus character, who he had heard of, who he knew things about, but he did not yet understand who Jesus was in the depths as his Savior. And then I think of this. You're blind. You haven't seen for who knows how long. You come to Jesus and he says, your faith has healed you. And in that moment, you open your eyes and you can see. And the very first thing that you see is Jesus' face. I try to put myself in that position and imagine what would I have seen if I'm opening my eyes for the first time in a long time and I see the face of Jesus. Now, some might think, like, oh, that's wonderful, that's lovely. My initial impression would have been, oh, that might have been tough. You're looking into the eyes of the God of the universe, and he's looking back at you, vulnerable. And your life flashes before your eyes, all your sin, all your brokenness, all your flaws. As he's staring into your soul, the very first thing you see is the God of the universe staring back at you and all of your brokenness. And yet, I don't believe that moment would have lasted long, because in all of that brokenness, there is Jesus saying, go, your faith has saved you. Your trust has saved you. Here's what I think he might have seen. We're going to go to that philosophical concept. There's this idea called the transcendentals. Okay, the transcendentals, I first learned about it, C.S. Lewis talks about it, and these are concepts that are true outside of time, space, and matter. And so C.S. Lewis quantified three of them, looking at philosophers from the past 2,000 years, and he said there's three main ideas that are true outside of time, space, and matter that actually point us back to God in every circumstance, and that is truth, goodness, and beauty. That if you look at these, in one sense, it actually proves the existence of God when you look at the fact that there's not just relative truth, but there is the truth. Well, something had to establish the absolute formation of truth. Something had to establish the absolute formation of goodness, because if there's a scale of good to bad, well, what is the goodest? What is the best? There had to have been an entity outside of time, space, and matter powerful enough to establish this is what is good. And same thing with beauty. If we're able to appreciate and recognize beauty, there had to be something that designed and created that. It wasn't just by chance that we have the ability to perceive and understand beauty. It is an intelligent design that built this. So C.S. Lewis builds an argument for the existence of God based off of these three ideas: true, good, and the beautiful. And when I look at these in context of the blind beggar, Bartimaeus, and then in deeper context of rejoice in the Lord always, I believe these become a starting point for how we can trust in God more. Let me show you. True. That which is true. If you're looking to trust in God, if you're looking to have a lens with which you can rejoice in the Lord always, always speak the truth. Or in the least, don't lie. Because in our process of speaking the truth and living in the truth, you might have heard it said that all truth is God's truth. And I do believe that if you keep pursuing the truth and you keep asking questions and you keep diving in deeper, you will indeed find the truth. And I believe that is Jesus, because he says it himself, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And so if you're in a process of doubting, you don't even know who this Jesus character is, you're looking at various even belief systems, my encouragement there is just don't stop asking questions. Keep asking questions. Keep pursuing. Don't ever get resolved in who you are. Keep pursuing the truth. And I truly believe you will find Jesus. Here's an interesting story that's wild. It's absolutely wild in terms of truth and people discovering God. Look at Genesis chapter 47, I think. There's the story of Joseph, right? He gets sold into slavery. He's going to Potiphar's house. There's the famine that happens. You guys hear the story of Joseph? Okay, perfect. In the middle, there's this random insert that takes up almost a whole chapter that has nothing to do with Joseph, seemingly. It's the story of Judah and how Judah has a son, and that son marries a woman named Tamar. Tamar is his wife. Judah's first son dies, and as was Jewish custom, the father, which would have been Judah, would have taken Tamar and given her to his second son. So that's what happens. Second son dies. So the custom would have been that Tamar would have gone to the third son. Judah's like, well, you've kind of been the result of two of my sons dying. We're going to hold off here for a second, which was against the law in that time, against cultural norms. And so he sets her on the side. Well, as the story gets much more interesting, Judah's one day going over to a festival, having a party. He sees a woman on the side of the road. And he's like, hey, let's have some fun. So they have some fun. But she says, wait, you need to give me something in return. He's like, I'll give you a goat. She's like, awesome. How am I going to get the goat? He says, well, I can give you my signet ring and the staff, and we'll trade it back. So we can do our thing now, and I'll give you a goat later. You'll give me my signet ring back. Awesome. Well, he goes. He sends someone to give her a goat. He can't find her. Some time passes on. Then it comes out. Tamar is pregnant. Dun, dun, dun. Scandal across the nation, right? Okay, so he comes, and he's like, Tamar's pregnant. You broke the law. Off with your head, you gotta die. And she's like, oh, well, the guy I was impregnated by, these things belong to him. Gasp, they're his things. Wild. In the middle of the story of Joseph, why is it there? And then he responds by saying, I am a sinful person. I'm the one who did wrong here. In fact, some commentators look at this and they say, here we have, at the end of Genesis, the very first time someone asks for forgiveness in the Bible. And I think that's absolutely fascinating because it was at this moment that he admitted to the truth that he was the one who had messed up. Now, if you know anything about the family, Judah was not the firstborn. Traditional lineages would have been traveled through the firstborn son. Judah was several down the line, and yet, if you look at the lineage of Jesus and where he comes from, it is not from the oldest. It's from Judah, the first person we see in the Bible admitting his wrongdoing and pursuing the truth. There seems to be something in this Bible that celebrates the fact of truth and us owning up to that, not us being perfect, but us living in the truth and acknowledging that the truth is the best possible outcome. And if we embrace that, and if we choose to see the truth in any scenario, whether that's between a relationship you have with someone, whether that's how you live your life, or just simply trying to be honest in your speech, your conduct, your actions, pursuing the truth is a way that will help you trust Jesus as you resolve to rejoice in your life. Let's hit the good. Oftentimes, I feel like we live life with this essence of life should be up here. And maybe falsely so. If I'm a Christian, life should be fantastic. Life should be good. Even, I think, culture misplaces this idea of happiness as the highest good. I just want to be happy. I just want my kids to be happy. If I make more money, then I can send my kids to college, and they can do that, and they can be happy. I don't think the Bible talks about trying to be happy. I think the Bible talks about trying to embrace that which is good. And so there's one philosopher he talks about. He says, oftentimes we think of life should be good. In any moment of pain or suffering, we go to God and we're like, oh, God, why aren't you there? And he says, no, you got to understand it's opposite. Because of sin in the world, we by nature have all of these limits. By nature of being alive, we have these limits. And so by nature of being alive, the cost of existence is suffering. And so if the cost of existence is suffering, any moment of non-suffering is God's goodness invading in. In fact, if you look at Genesis 1, he creates the heavens and the earth, and he says, it is good, it is good, it is good. This is God establishing, here's the bar. But when sin came and stripped all that away, if you were to take God's goodness out of the equation, well, that is hell. And so when you encounter hell on this earth, it is a result of the corruption and the dismantling of sin on God's creation. But when you encounter goodness, even if it's for a fleeting moment, that's God's divine intervention in your life. And so if you flip it on its head and you think of it like this, instead of walking around thinking, oh, my life's so bad, how come it can't be here? You can think the cost of me being alive should be down here. But praise be to God, there is goodness to encounter. Praise be to God, I was able to wake up. Praise be to God, I have clothes. Praise be to God, there is a spectrum of goodness that I can encounter to give me just a hint of what it will be like in the age to come where the fullness of God's creation is restored. So if you walk around life looking for the good, not looking for the bad, but looking for the good, you will see God's divine intervention everywhere in your life. And so if you're trying to figure out how to trust God so that you can rejoice in the Lord always, well, you can embrace the truth, tell the truth, pursue the truth. You can also, well, see the good. See where God is at work. See where there is a momentary lapse in suffering. And said that last one, the beautiful, the true, the good, the beautiful. When you look out in this world, there's plenty of beauty to observe that you can experience. We have five senses, right? To encounter the goodness, whether it's Joan's cookies, that's good, or whether it's a beautiful plant that's sprouting a flower, that's beautiful. When we see beauty around us, it is not by chance that we can encounter beauty. It is an intelligent design that put that into place. And so it might be hard to recognize God at work, but when you feel the wind against your face, when you see a flower, when you taste a cookie, when you encounter a warm embrace from a loved one, it's God's beauty surrounding you when you might not have even recognized it. Even in your darkest place, your place of depression, where there is no hope, where there is no feeling, where you might look at a beautiful cookie or a flower and just have apathy, you can still recognize the beauty therein that lies in that creation. And that mindset shift of seeing God's beauty at play, seeing God's goodness involved in your life, seeing God's truth ruminating throughout, will begin to build you a framework outside of time, space, and matters that helps you trust in Jesus. And as that develops and as that matriculates, your ability to rejoice in the Lord always shifts from an emotional state to a concrete set of practices that you can engage with. So you may be filled with wholeness, so that you may grow in your character. Because it's not going to be easy to see the truth in people. It's not going to be easy to resolve yourself to see the good, even in tough situations. It's going to be really difficult, in fact, especially when there's deep pain and suffering, like you're visiting a loved one in the hospital, or when a loved one dies and you have this terrible pain, and yet we can all recognize that there's moments to laugh even in pain. There's moments to celebrate even in trials. And so when you can see the good in that, when you can see the beauty in that, when you can see the truth in that, we begin to train our minds on how to see things not from position like James and John, but we can position ourselves in this almost state of desperation of, God, I just need you. I just need to see you. And I'll close with this. I'm going to invite the worship team to come up. All of this is a perspective on how you can see God and how you can do part to approach that. But the beauty that I think in all of this is before the blind man ever saw God, Jesus saw him. And I want you to get that. Before the blind man ever saw Jesus, before he ever did my three steps of truth, goodness, and beauty, before he did any of that, Jesus saw him. And Jesus called him. And Jesus drew him unto himself. And you can't forget that. You can't forget that God has reached out his hand first, and he sees you. And while you might feel the weight of sin, you might feel the weight of depression, you might feel the weight of life, and as 2023 hits you, you might feel the weight of that coming against you like a rushing train. Never forget that Jesus sees you first, and he will never give you something that he can't handle. He will never let you go. And what you might see is the very worst possible thing, which is death, he sees as a transition into the age to come where you will be fully made new and made whole. So no matter your circumstance, as painful as it might be, or as joyous as it might be, rejoice in the Lord always. Because even if you're in prison, writing to other people to try to give them a semblance of hope, there is reason to rejoice because God's truth is in this world. God's goodness is in this world. And God's beauty is in this world. I want to invite you to close your eyes. And we're going to take a minute or two just to reflect. You know, life can be so busy for me that sometimes I don't take enough time to reflect. And so we're going to craft 2 whole minutes for you to reflect. Where might you embrace God's truth? Where might you see God's goodness in your life? Where might have you missed God's beauty that in this moment of reflection you can just say, thank you, God, for? You might even be too broken right now to do that. You might be sitting at home online trying to figure out how to even get there. And you might just need to be reminded that Jesus sees you in this moment. But take 2 minutes to practice this aspect of resolving, like the blind beggar, to get to the face of Jesus and see where he is at work in truth, goodness, and beauty. We're going to then close that time with remembering the ultimate goodness that God has given us, which is salvation from sin and death, and we'll take communion together. But to lead into that, reflect on how you might rejoice in the Lord in this moment.
God, we just thank you and we praise you. We thank you for this time that we can reflect on your truth and your goodness and your beauty. Lord, as we go into this time of communion, may we be reminded of all that is true and good and beautiful about you. And especially about your son Jesus, who gave his life for us. And that this communion, this sacrament, is a tangible way for us to remember the grace that has been poured upon us and continues to be poured upon us day in and day out. It is a gift that you give to us. You indeed see us before we ever see you. You're initiating love through this meal. May we remember this. And so may this bread and this juice for us today be signs of this grace. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, brothers and sisters in Christ, as we come to this communion time, we are reminded that this is all truth, goodness, and beauty. This is through Jesus' sacrifice for us, and that is what we are remembering today. And so on the night that Jesus was arrested, when he was with his disciples, he took bread. And after giving thanks to God the Father, he broke the bread. And he gave it to them. And he said, "This is my body. Take and eat. And do it in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after the meal, he took the cup. And he said, "This is a sign of the new covenant poured out through my shed blood for you, for the forgiveness of sins. And so when you drink of this cup, do it in remembrance of me." And Paul reminds us that every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we are proclaiming the saving death of our Lord Jesus Christ and the beauty that he will come again in glory, which is good news for us here today. Amen. And so, friends, you hopefully received your elements on the way in. If not, there are ushers who are around with these. And so now as we take our communion, the wafer is at the top. You can peel the top back and take your wafer and then drink the juice. Brothers and sisters in Christ, this is the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken and shed for us for the forgiveness of sins. Take and eat. Beautiful things that Jesus taught us in his life was how to pray. And so I invite you to rise if you're able, and together in one voice, we are going to pray that prayer that Jesus taught us. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, hey, you made it to New Year's Day, the beginning of 2023. We hope if you're local, to get to know you more. We have, as you heard from Shannon earlier, a bunch of activities and events and programming. But most importantly, the reason we do all that is so we can come together in community and grow in our faith with Jesus through spiritual formation practices. So we invite you along the journey with us in 2023. And so today, as you go, may you go resolving to be truthful and to see the truth at work. May you go resolving to see God's goodness in every aspect of life that surrounds you. May you go resolving to see God's beauty in the world around you, so that you may rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again, rejoice. Go in peace.